Look, look.
Is it John 7:7 that says the world cannot hate you, but it hates me?
Yeah.
7:7.
John chapter 7 verse 7 says that the world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify that the deeds thereof are evil. Listen, the deeds of the Pope and the deeds of this world are evil. And if you are partakers of this and of this whore of Babylon, you will be a partaker of her sins and her plagues. You need to come out from among her. Come out of her. Right now, flee from this place. Turn away. Repent. Seek the Lord. You need to understand that they're going into here, that you're being a partaker of her sins. The sins of the Pope, the sins of Catholicism. The word Catholic means universal. It means let's unify. Let's make one world religion. No more Jesus, no more Buddha, no names. We'll just have a God. And that's understanding that Satan is the God of this world. Understanding that you will worship Satan and himself. He loves this. He has you deceived. He has you walking in like sheep towards the slaughter. But you need the good shepherd, Jesus Christ. He's the shepherd. He is the door. He says, any man that comes in through me shall find green pasture. But anyone that goes in some other way is same as a thief and a robber. And they shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Listen, what would it profit you to gain this event and gain going in there and lose your soul? The Bible says, what would it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? In the end, we have heaven or hell. That's it. Eternal damnation or eternal life through Jesus Christ. You know, we are under grace, absolutely. But the grace of God should teach you and understand. And you should understand that you can no longer willfully walk in sin. Titus 2:11 says that for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying worldly lust and ungodliness, we should live righteously, soberly, and godly in this present world. This present world, we should live that way, not the world to come, because we're regenerated by the Holy Spirit, born again. Except a man be born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. There's the same Jesus that said that, said, unless you repent, you shall likewise perish. Not the ecumenical Jesus that says, John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever shall believe on him shall have everlasting life. He also said, he sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but through him the world might be saved. He that believes is not condemned, but he that believes not is condemned already. Do you believe? Or are you in condemnation? Do you have the belief that devils have? They believe that there is one God. They do. You do well. But even the devils believe, and they tremble. Some of you don't even tremble at the fact that there is one God, and his name is Jesus Christ. You don't tremble at that. You don't tremble that he's coming back in flaming fire, reaping vengeance on those who know not God. You don't tremble at that. You don't tremble at his voice. When John saw Jesus in Revelation chapter 1, he fell as a dead man before his feet. He said he fell as dead. Is that you when you come to the presence of the Lord and understand who you serve and who you are in front of? Or is he going to be your judge? Is he your savior or is he your judge? Will he say, depart from me, you who work in you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Because Hebrews chapter 9 says that, you know, it is appointed unto man to die once, and then after this comes the judgment. Where will you stand in that day? Will he say, you are standing before me naked and destitute, and depart from me, and outside, will you be outside with weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth? Behold, outside of the dogs, the sorcerers, the whoremongers, and whosoever loves and makes a lie. You love your lies. That's the issue. You turn your ear from the truth and you turn into a fable. You love the lies. You love the lies that the Pope, you love the lies that your pastors have been teaching you because they itch your ears. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but having itching ears after their own lust, they will heap upon themselves teachers. That's the issue. America has hirelings. We don't have pastors. We don't have true men of God running the church. We have hirelings. And Jesus said the hirelings flee when the wolves come. But the true good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And this is love, that a man lay down his life for his friends. That's what Jesus Christ did. Lay down his life for us while we were yet sinners. When we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Yet for a good man would some even dare to die, but peradventure for a righteous man would none even die. But God commends his love to us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He died for us. But we can't live publicly for him. He died publicly for us. Why can't we publicly live for him? Why is he just a keychain we carry around? Why is he just a picture on our phone? Why is he not our daily life, our daily bread? You know, we need to eat of the bread of Jesus daily. He said, your fathers ate of the bread that the manna that fell from heaven. But if they had eaten of this bread, and they, you know, they fell dead in the wilderness. But if they ate of the bread that I provide, they would live eternally.
You know, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. And it come, all who thirst. You thirst and hunger for righteousness, any of you. For you shall be filled, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Living water you can have that flowing from your belly if you would just come and hunger and thirst after Jesus Christ. He promises to fulfill you, but you must seek him. Seek him right now while he may be found. The book of Amos says that there will be a famine upon the land, not of food and not of water, but of the word of God. What are you going to do when the government comes for your Bibles and comes for your apps and shuts you down and you can't get a word of God? What will you do? Where will you go? Who will you seek? Will you just willfully take the mark and just forfeit your soul so simply for a love of money or a love of pleasure? Sin is pleasurable yet for a season, but it passes. No, love not the world, neither the things that are in this world. For all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. You understand that when you sow to this world and you're enjoying this world, you're appealing to either your eyes, your flesh, or your pride. God hates the proud, but gives grace to the humble. You need to humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. He shall exalt you. He'll lift you up, not as the praise of man, but the praise of God. The praise of the Lord. He can lift you up. He can raise you. He can bring you back from the dead. If you do not have this Holy Spirit, you are a dead man walking. The Pope is dead in his transgressions. Dead. Dead. He needs to repent. And see, but he's under the influence of Satan. You understand, when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, in the desert, Satan said, I will give you all power over all these nations. You can rule these. And he said, get behind me, Satan. You are told to worship the Lord thy God and thine only. Don't you understand that Satan has dominion and principalities and powers? That's who we war against. There are darkness and high places. But our weapons of warfare are not carnal, but they're spiritual. We need to understand that we need to pray and fast. And a lot of the NIV, the non-inspired version Bible, says that it's actually missing thousands of words, missing tons of verses. There's a very, very important verse that's missing. Matthew 17, verse 21, it says, but these kind do not go out by prayer and fasting. We need to understand those are our weapons of warfare, prayer, fasting, understanding the word of God, hiding in our heart that we may not sin against the Lord. We need to understand that because Satan has no way to defeat him, so he's trying to take our sword away because the word of the God is the sword. Understand, it's sharp and living and sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing the soul and the spirit and the bones from the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. What are your intents of your heart? What are your thoughts? What's going on inside your heart? The Lord sees that. He says, I am the Lord who searches the heart and even tries the reins to give according to every man to their deeds and of their works. I know, are you in darkness and you don't want to be exposed so you don't come to the light? Give God that broken and contrite spirit Psalms 51 talks about. He will not despise it. He will lift you up. He will repair you. He's your creator. He doesn't need your acceptance. You don't need to accept him into your heart. He's God. He's Jesus Christ. He's the King of kings and Lord of lords. He said, before Abraham was, I am. That's who we serve. We don't need to. He doesn't need our acceptance. Who is man that God is mindful of us? Who is he? Who are we? We are nothing. And if salt loses its savor, it is not good but to be trampled underfoot by men. We need to understand that we are the light of the world if we have Jesus Christ who said, I am the light of the world within us. His Holy Spirit living within you, being born again. That's what needs to happen. You can't by the flesh overcome your sin because then it'll be of yourself and you could boast. But you need to understand that you take the Holy Spirit, that Jesus Christ will liberate. It says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. He liberates you from your sin. I was in bondage. I was in chains. I could not break my sin. But by the Spirit and the grace of God, he gave me his spirit of liberty. And I had liberty. I overcame my sin by the power of Jesus Christ, who died and rose again, having death no having power over him, defeated death in the grave. But you must come to him and not go to events where you trust in men, trusting in chariots and horses and not the Lord. The Lord says, let him that glory in this, that he understands me and knows me, that I am the Lord that execute loving kindness, righteousness, and judgment in the earth. Do you know that God? Do you know him? Or do you know the Jesus that they're promoting, the promotional Jesus Christ, that gets people to fill events, that gets people to fill, you know, this field over here? But the issue is, we need to understand that the truth will set you free. And many men in the last days will be lovers of themselves, loving themselves more than the Lord. How many people out here have a Facebook full of just selfies? Just all about me. Look at me. Look what I'm doing today. Look what you can do for me. Jesus, what can you do for me? when actually, you know, we're supposed to be servants of the Lord Most High, and the greatest amongst you should serve the least of these. Jesus came not to be ministered unto, but to minister. That's what Jesus came for. He came to minister unto us, that we could be set free and saved. He washed his apostles' feet. Oh, friends, please get this. Please understand. Please flee from the wrath. Flee from the wrath to come. The Lord will come back with flaming fire. He's going to reap vengeance upon all of his enemies. He's sharpening instruments of death right now for his enemies. If this is foolishness to you, the Bible says that the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those who perish. You're perishing. The Bible says that he who hates me, says the Lord, loves death. Do you love death? Do you not want to abide with the God Most High for eternity? But he said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I have said? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I have said? Over there, brother. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do as I have said? As I have told you, why are you not a faithful servant to me? Why aren't you faithful to me? Why, when I came back, you are not doing what I have told you to? The Bible says that when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on the earth? I don't know. Will he find faithful on the earth? Will he find that remnant that he's looking for? Faith without works is dead, being alone. Do you understand? I can show you my faith by my works. You know, faith is impossible to please the Lord. Because that he that comes to him must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. It's not just a one-time sinner's prayer. It's diligence, it's prayer, it's fasting, it's denying of self. Deny yourself, pick up your cross and follow me. For any man who does not follow me is not worthy of me, Jesus said. And if you do not love me more than you love your mother, your brother, your sister, or even your children, you are not worthy of me, Jesus Christ said. Do you love him more and then you will forsake this whole world? Remember Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife. She put her hand in the plow to leave Sodom, and she turned around and was turned to a pillar of salt. Remember that when you came out of the world, when you received the Lord Jesus Christ, you must understand that you can't turn back. Hebrews chapter 6 says that if any man has tasted of the heavenly gift and the Holy Ghost and all the things to come and turns away, he can't be restored back to repentance. This is serious. You need to understand that Jesus is standing here willing to give you a chance, willing to instead of reset you, you can repent. Reset will do nothing. We need to repent. Resetting is just when you turn the computer off and you reset it and you turn it back on, the computer does the same thing. That's all. But when you repent, you turn, you throw that computer away, you get a brand new one, you become a new creation in Jesus Christ. And it's no longer you that live, but he that lives within you. You die to your flesh, your flesh is no longer. But you have an issue, the flesh is still there. Because he who sows to the flesh shall of the flesh reap destruction, but he who sows to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. You can reap everlasting life, but you have a free will. We have this free will that God gave us so we can come to him in sincerity and worship him in spirit and truth. Any man that worships Jesus must do it in spirit and in truth. You cannot worship Jesus with anything else except you have the Spirit of the Lord. These songs that they're singing is you know, Colossians chapter 3, verse 16 says, let the word of Christ dwell richly within you, admonishing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. These aren't psalms. These just itch your ear, just like the Pope is. You know, the King David said in Psalm 5:5, you hate all workers of iniquity, and that's a song. He sings the whole truth, the goodness and the severity of God. Behold, goodness to you if you continue in his goodness, but severity to all those who fell. What does that mean? That means enduring to the end. Enduring, you gotta have endurance, you must overcome, and you can do that through the Spirit of Jesus Christ. But you're forsaking it. You're coming here to trust in men and have your ears itched. You're giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. They're deceiving you. In 1 Corinthians, Paul talks about the preaching of a false Christ. By the subtlety of the spirit, by the subtlety of the serpent, you can receive a different spirit, a counterfeit Holy Ghost. It'll make you believe that you feel better, or you know, we're believing in the Holy Spirit for miracles, money, setting free from depression, whatever it may be. But what about what he was sent for? To be holy. Be holy, for I am holy, the Lord says. You know, and he said, I will not leave you comfortless, but I will send you the comforter, the teacher who will teach you all things, the counselor. We don't see these in the churches nowadays because the churches are run by the 501c3, the love of money. The love of money is the root of all evil. The root of all evil. Timothy makes that clear. Paul writes that in Timothy. We understand, you know, what would it profit you to gain everything, everything in this world, but lose your soul? You need to repent, folks. Seek the Lord. He is light, and in him is no darkness. And if we say we have fellowship with that light, but still walk in darkness, we are a liar. Liars do not inherit the kingdom of God. It says, whosoever loves a lie is outside, where the dogs and the sorcerers are. We need to understand that we need to be broken and humble before the Lord to be lifted up. We need to repent. It's not about what I can do. No longer. It's no longer I that lives. For I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But yet not I that lives, but Christ that lives within me. And this life that I live now in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who gave himself for me, and he loved me. Jesus said that if you love him, you will keep his commandments. And the love of God is this, that we keep his commandments and they are not grievous to you. You rejoice in his commandment because his word is life. Jesus said something very, a very hard word, and Peter said, you speak a hard word, Jesus. And Jesus said, will you flee also? He said, where shall we go? For your words are eternal life. Your words bear life. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. Are you living by every word? Are you seeking the Bible? Are you reading the word which was made into flesh, manifested in the flesh, seen amongst men, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory? Are you reading that? Or are you just taking what man, doctrines of men, are feeding you? Teaching for commandments the doctrines of men, the Bible says. You know, in the book of Acts, there were people that were counted righteous because after they heard the preaching of the gospel, they checked it daily to see if it was so. Are you doing that? Or are you letting your pastor just feed you what he wants, his agenda? His agenda. It's agendas. Agendas everywhere. But Christ has one for your life, and that is repentance towards God and faith towards the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand? God is a consuming fire. He'll never be quenched. Never. And that if we continue to walk in willful sin after receiving a knowledge of the Lord, there no longer remains a sacrifice for our sins, but a fearful expectation of the fire and indignation that consumes the adversaries. You know, many of you, and I know this because it was true in my life when I was lukewarm. I'm not diligent, I'm slothful. You know, the Bible says to the slothful servant, depart from me, you slothful and wicked servant. You know, go to the ant, you sluggard, and inquire of her ways. Go, you know, an ant is diligent in all she does. She works, she's always going. We need to be like that. We need to train our hands, train our members to be subjected to Christ. You know, I 1 Corinthians 9:27 says, I beat my body into subjection that after I preach unto you, I may not be a castaway. Take your body, take your flesh, put it under you, put it underneath you. You can by the Spirit of God. But if you don't have the Spirit of God, you're not going to overcome. You need that. That's your power. That's your life. You know, that's Jesus said, you know, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man can come unto the Father but me, but through me. And, you know, the Pope has been openly saying that a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus is dangerous. What does that mean? Why is it dangerous? There's no radical Christians blowing anything up. It's dangerous to his agenda and what he's pushing. It's dangerous to what he wants to unite everybody, because Jesus said, I did not come to bring peace, but I came to bring a sword, and that a man's enemies will be among his own house. That's who your enemies will be. But we must love our enemies. We won't go decapitate our enemy. We love them. We pray for them. We bless them. But also we must expose them and rebuke. You know, we're loving our neighbor as ourselves when we warn people to repent and flee the wrath to come. Right now, you're an enemy of the cross. This isn't pleasing to those who perish, because it says we are the aroma of death unto those who perish, but the aroma of life unto those who are living. If you rejoice in this and you don't understand what's going on, seek wisdom. Seek understanding. No scripture is given by private interpretation. It's all given by the Holy Spirit. And if you ask for understanding, the Lord can reveal that to you. And you can understand what the gospel means. What it means to turn and forsake your sin. Forsake. It says, my people perish for a lack of knowledge. Because, you know, they because you have forgotten the law of my God, I will forget you. I will also forget your children. Do you want that to happen? Do you want to lack, you know, because you don't have knowledge? You can have that right now, today. Don't say, I'm going to go to this event and I'm going to come home. Because Jesus gave a parable and said, thou fool, I require your soul tonight. Today is the day of salvation. Today is right now is the time to get right. Don't go in there and think that you're going to have tomorrow. Because any man that thinks on the morrow and says that I will do this or I will do that, and I'll go into this city and buy and sell, that is evil, the Bible says. Because who are you to take an account of your life? You are nobody, because it's appointed unto man to die once, and then after this comes the judgment. We need to understand that we aren't sovereign over our own lives. We didn't even give ourselves breath. We can't even save ourselves. Yet man has pride. Satan had pride. He got cast from heaven for that. God resists the proud. And he says that in the day of your calamity, he will mock you when you cry out to him, because God does not hear the prayer of sinners. You need to repent and seek the Lord. It's not a sinner's prayer. It's repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the Holy Ghost. That's a promise. And it also says in the book of Timothy, it says that, yes, all those that live godly in Christ Jesus suffer persecution. That scripture really, really changed my walk with the Lord, because as I'm professing Christ, I'm living on easy street. I have no issues, no quarrels with man, nothing. No persecution. Do you understand that the world doesn't hate you, but it hates the Lord, because he testifies that his deeds are evil. You need to be testifying, standing up. It says, who will rise up for me against the workers of iniquity, the evildoers? Who will lift up my voice? Lift up thy voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their sins, and to the tribe of Judah their transgression. Do you understand, folks? Your sin has separated you from God. It has turned his face from you. It says that your sins have separated you from God, and he's turned your face from you. And your iniquity has hid it from you. But God is patient. He doesn't want any to perish. He wants you all to come to repentance. He's not slack concerning his judgment, as men consider slackness. He wants all to come to repentance. But there will come a time when he will give you over, as Romans chapter 1 says, to the fulfillment of your lust. He can give you over to a reprobate mind, a debased mind where you can't think. You know, even men will burn with lust toward other men, and women exchanging the natural use of the man for the woman. We understand that God is no one to play games with. He's serious, he is righteous, he is holy. Yes, God is love, and that he showed his love to us through his Son, Jesus Christ. But he's also righteous and holy. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Holiness is living upright, and righteousness is upright before the Lord. Going and sinning no more. And if any man sin, he is an advocate with the Father, who is a propitiation for our sins. It says if, not when. We don't premeditate sin. We don't work sin. That's why he said, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Because they're working it. Their hands, their feet are swift to shed evil, to shed blood. They lay in wait for the innocent. That's what's going on. But when you're in sin, you plan it, you meditate upon it, and your flesh just has total reign. But when you come to the Spirit of God, you hate sin. You are to love God and to hate sin. It's not what Mahatma Gandhi, the Hindu, says: love the sinner, hate the sin. That's false, because it says, do not fear the one who can, after kill the body and do nothing else, but fear the one who, after killing the body, throws the soul to hell. That sounds not very loving to me, to throw somebody into hell. But this is his love, that he's coming out to you to reach out and reconcile you and translate you from the kingdom of darkness into his marvelous light. His marvelous light which men beheld, and they loved darkness because their deeds were evil. And no man comes to the light, lest his deeds be reproved. Do you understand that your sin will find you out? Numbers 32 verse 23 says, behold, and if you will not do so, your sins will find you out. You will be exposed. The Bible says that whatever is done in darkness, I will expose in the light. Jesus is going to bring everything to light when he rewinds the tape. What's going to be of you? Are you going to be, welcome in, my good and faithful servant, well done, or depart from me, and get him out of here? You know, we despise and try to prepare how to scheme and how to get out of things, but there's one scheme you can never get away with. Is sin against the holy God. He will bind you hand and foot, in which you cannot break, and he will cast you out, and he will ask you, where was your wedding garment? How did you get here without your garment? And you say, get him out of here. He was not invited, for many are called, but few are chosen. We're all called. He's calling out right now. Repent. Repent, but few are chosen. You know, narrow is the way that leads to life, and few there be that find it, but broad is the way, and wide is the path that leads to destruction, and many there be on. But strive to enter in at the straight gate. Enter in at the straight gate. Man, you need to repent. You seek the Lord. It's not an, if you love the word, if you were of God, you would receive his word, because Jesus said that if you are of me, you hear my word. If you were my sheep, you would hear my word. You'd hear my voice. My sheep hear my voice. This is the word of God. This is not my opinion. This is not what I believe. This is my political view. This is Jesus Christ and him crucified, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, and we present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. We want you to be perfected. Perfected. Be ye perfect as he is perfect. Over there, man. Be ye perfect as he is perfect. Perfection comes through repentance and faith. God has mercy on those who seek mercy. But you know, rebellion, the scripture talks about rebellion towards God is as sorcery. In Revelation, it says that they repented not of their sorcery. And when these woes came unto you, but woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you make the outside of the cup clean and beautiful looking, but the inside is full of wickedness and ravenings. Everyone cleans up to look nice to come to an event, but what does the inside look like? What does the man that Jesus Christ sees look like? Is he full of extortion? Is he full of murder? Is he full of covetousness? Do you understand when you look upon a woman or another man with lust, it's adultery in your heart? Do you understand that? When you hate your brother without cause, you are a murderer. You're guilty of the judgment. And if you shall say to your brother, thou fool, you are in danger of hell fire, scripture says. Don't call any man father, for there is one father, he who is in heaven. Why is the Pope called father? That's right there. Right? It's a heresy. Mark the heretic after the first and second admonition and then cast him out. Why is he not casted out? Because that which is esteemed amongst men is an abomination to the Lord. Do you understand that abominations get countries wiped out? Sodom and Gomorrah was an abomination. It says, these six things does the Lord hate. Seven are abomination to him. The first one is a proud look. And the second one is a lying tongue. You understand that Sodom and Gomorrah, homosexuality is an unnatural sin. It's an abomination to the Lord. And that's why Sodom and Gomorrah had to get destroyed. But he seek and sought the righteous. He said that if he had even found 10 righteous, he would have repented. He would have changed his mind. But he couldn't even find 10 righteous. And that's the issue here. The Pope is lifting himself up. He says, I am the mediator between God and man on this earth. No, there is one who is in heaven who is the mediator between God and man and the Lord Jesus Christ. That's who it is. Him and him crucified. Do you understand that he shed his holy, spotless blood with no guile in his mouth, with no sin, spotless, perfect, spotless sacrifice lamb, the Passover lamb. When you receive him, you can become passed over from death unto life. You can pass over, but you need to accept that. You need to be washed in the blood of Jesus. Are you covered? Are your sins forgiven? Have you been forgiven by the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the great I am? Do you understand that your sins have separated you? Your sin, your rebellion towards God is what sin is. It's a transgression of his law and his commandment. Do you understand that you will be judged regardless if you believe or not? You will be judged according to everything that you've done. By your word you shall be justified, and by your word you shall be condemned. Now, do you profess the Lord with your mouth and then speak blasphemies? How so? This ought not be so, scripture says. It says that, does a fountain bring forth fresh water and salt? You know, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. If you're speaking perverse things, you have a perverted heart. You have murder in your heart. You have a sewer for a heart. But don't you understand that the tongue can no man tame? It is a world, it's a world of fire full of deadly poison. Do you understand that no man can tame this tongue? You know, we can bridle the beasts and everything in the world can be tamed. All the animals, but we can't tame the tongue. We need the Spirit of Jesus Christ who can come into us and give us the power over these things to be set free, redeemed, delivered, overcome. But we, you know, these people draw, Jesus said, these people draw near to me with their mouths and with their lips do they honor me, but their heart is far from me. And their fear towards me is taught by the precepts of men. You let men tell you what you think in regards to God. Let God reveal himself to you when you seek him. Let him show you how mighty and powerful he is. Let him show you how holy and just and perfect he is. Let him reveal that to you. Don't let man say, God doesn't care, it's okay, he's overlooking that. No. Jesus said, go and sin no more, lest the worst thing come upon you. And if any man goes back to his sin, he's like a dog going back to his vomit, just as a fool goes back to his folly. Don't you understand that you're not supposed to lean on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Don't you want direction in your life? Don't you?
You know, the Savior said, he said, if you want to be my disciple, you have to give up all your own possessions.
What scripture is that?
Luke 14:33.
Can you recite it for me?
I'll read it to you.
The problem is it's denominational. You're dividing yourself against true saints of God. And it says, the body of Christ divided?
So likewise, whoever of you who does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple.
Okay. Have you forsaken everything you've had? Yeah. Family included?
Family?
Yep. Okay. So I've talked to another couple of you guys over there, and they said otherwise. You know, you guys are all living together. Forsaking means to not love, to not enjoy. Obviously, we know that the body needs clothing. We know meat for the belly. We need these things. These are necessities. And it says, does not the Lord who cares for the ravens of the fowls of the air, will he not much more? you need Jesus Christ. No denominational. Denominations of the devil, of Babylon, you know, when they were dispersed, everyone has a private interpretation of what the Bible says. But no, it is one baptism, one faith, one Lord, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. He came to set sinners free. And you guys are denying that. It says, under the pure, all things are pure, but under the defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure. But even their mind and conscience is defiled. They profess to know God, but in their works they deny him. Being abominable, disobedient, and to every good work, reprobate. Are you professing to know God, but denying him in your works? You know, the Bible says that if you know to do good and you do it not, that is a sin unto you. And Jesus said himself, if you do not believe that I am he, you shall die in your sins. What does it mean to believe in Jesus? What does that mean? It means to participate in grace. It means to let grace change you. Let it teach you. Let grace make you understand that how you once were in your new creation and walk in newness of life. It says that any man who is born of God, you know, any man that was born again is a new creation. Behold, all things have passed away and all things have become new. That means you've come out from among them. You no longer touch what is unclean. And he receives you as a father. Is the heavenly father your father? Is he ashamed to call you his God? You know, scripture says in Hebrews chapter 11 that these all died in the faith, speaking of Abraham, Moses, and all the great prophets of old, saying these all have died in the faith, understanding that they were not partakers of this world, and that they were sojourning for a country that is a heavenly country. And God, because of their faith, that true faith, that provided works, that had salvation, said that God was not ashamed to be called their God. Wow, what more could you want? You know, but instead, Satan's blinded you to think that this world has so much to offer you, that Jesus Christ wants to give you all the riches of the world. And Jesus said, are you sure you want to follow me? For foxes have holes and birds have nests, but I have nowhere to lay my head. Do you understand that? It's not a prosperity gospel. All that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Do you understand? We can't bring Bibles into high schools nowadays, but we can let a million Christians gather on the Capitol property in Washington, D.C. to worship Jesus. Something's wrong there. Satan's not threatened by you. He understands that you guys are yet babes in Christ, if even. And he understands that you're not gonna thwart his plans. You're not gonna be a threat to him. He actually probably leads you. He leads most of the churches. Because the head of the church is Christ. But the 501c3 head is the government. They have to censor. They have to compromise what they preach. You don't hear the truth in these apostate churches. This is apostasy. This is uniting religions. What the false prophet shall do in the end times, you've heard it is written that there shall be one world government, one world ruler, the Antichrist, and one religion. And that is what the Catholic Church, the universal church, wants to do and wants to unite everyone. But we can't have unity with the Lord Jesus Christ because he said, can two walk together lest they be agreed? That's in the book of Amos. I can't walk with those who are willfully denying the Lord Jesus Christ. Who is my vitality? He fills me up daily. I'm a vessel of honor because of him. He's crafted me by a potter's hand. Does not the potter have power over the clay? He can mold you into a vessel and fill you up and let your cup run overflowing to where you're overwhelmed with him and his presence. But instead you forsake that. Instead of forsaking your sin, you know, forsake Pope Francis and turn to Jesus. It's all. Forsake these lukewarm bands that sound too much like the world. You know, he who is a friend of the world is the enemy of God. You adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship with the world is enmity towards God? Whosoever therefore shall be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. And the enemies of God are thrown outside where there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. And even the lukewarm believers who are not prepared for when the Lord comes back as the 10 virgins were, who did not have their wicks trimmed and their oil filled, they were left outside. And he said, I know you not. They pounded on the door and said, Lord, let me in. And he said, I know you not. And they even called him Lord. That sounds like a sinner's prayer. They said the sinner's prayer. They were kind of, you know, going through the motions. But they weren't ready. They weren't prepared. They didn't have the faith in every word that came out of the mouth of God. When you have that faith, you believe in Jesus and you believe in what he said. You need to understand that Jesus is calling you out of your sin, out of this lukewarmness, out of this world. Because this world is not our home. It says, forsake the world and all of its riches. Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. You shall be, you know, there's glory and riches in God and Jesus Christ's wisdom. Find wisdom and sell it not. It's a treasure to hold. You need to hold wisdom. We need discernment in these last days. As spiritual deception comes, the Lord says that even the elect would be deceived if it were possible. You need to understand that you can be deceived. Don't think that you can't be. Because there's coming a deception that will take the world by storm. And if you are not found in Christ Jesus and he's not upholding you, you will be deceived also. And you will believe a lie and you will love the lie. You know that you will not receive the love of the truth. You need to have that love of the truth or you're going to fall short. You're not going to make it into the kingdom. You need to run the race. Paul says, you know, I train my body, not as beating the air, but I have a mission. I'm set forth to strive and enter into the kingdom of heaven, which I was ordained to preach unto, to preach Christ, to preach Jesus Christ unto you, that you may receive him and repent and turn from your wickedness and your lukewarmness. Because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Jesus said, he said, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Are you being rebuked? Are you being chastened when you fall short of what the Lord's expecting you? Are you hearing his voice? Are you receiving his chastisement? Or are you just as a bastard child who's not punished, who is just left to go astray? You know, we rejoice in those things. We rejoice in our triumphs. Paul had an issue, and he cried out to the Lord saying, heal me of it. And Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for you. So my grace is sufficient for you. Is this grace sufficient for you? Or do you keep seeking the things of this world, the things that fulfill your lusts? Let no man say that when he is tempted of God. For he's tempted of his own self. Because his lust brings forth sin. And when sin is finished, not every man is tempted when it's his own lust. And lust, when it is, brings forth sin, when it is conceived. And when it is finished, brings forth death. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. For we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The key word is have. We don't continue therein. We repent. We walk away. We no longer seek the things that once fulfilled our flesh. And the Holy Spirit will quench that lust. And he will turn you into righteousness. You will love righteousness. Jesus said that except a man be born again, he shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Are you born again? Are you regenerated by the Holy Spirit? Are your sins forgiven? Are you a child of God? Are you a child of the devil? Little children, do not be deceived. He who does righteousness is righteous just as he is righteous. But he who sins is of the devil. Are you sinning? Are you a sinner? Are you a Christian sinner? There's no such thing. It's like saying a married bachelor. You know, it's a lie. We're no longer sinners but saints. For it says, for the time has come, the judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us, where shall the end be there of those who obey not the gospel of God? Will scarcely the righteous man be saved? Where shall the ungodly and sinner appear? That's 1 Peter 4:17 through 19. Where will you appear if you're an ungodly and sinner? If you're ungodly and you're a sinner, where will you appear? You will end up in hell, the pit. Let the blind lead the blind, and they shall fall into the ditch. That ditch is hell. Don't follow these blind pastors who do not have the light of their eye. The eye, which is the lamp of the body, is the light of the body. And if that light be darkness, how great is that darkness? King David said, no evil thing will I put before my eyes, O Lord. Are you looking at filth on your Facebook? Are you looking at filth on YouTube? Pornography? Are you looking at women with lust? Are you filling your body with darkness? So the light's not in you. Jesus said, the Bible says that Jesus will purge us of our iniquities because he is faithful and just to forgive us. He will purge that from you. It's not just passive. He's purging it. He's removing it. He's working on you. He's taking out the kinks. But you must cry to him and understand that in a humble heart. Don't be proud and say, I don't need that. Because the neck of the proud is, you know, the haughty is stiff before destruction. Don't harden your heart. Do you have a calloused heart? Is your heart hardened to not receive the word of God? Do you want to receive today? You can receive it today, right now. You can repent and leave this place and turn home and have salvation. Salvation can enter into thy house today. But many will have a hardened heart. Of unbelief. It says, take heed, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is yet today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Sin is deceitful. Sin creeps into your life. It hardens your heart. It turns you away from God. You feel ashamed. Then the accuser of the brethren, who is Satan, will come. And he'll accuse you, and he'll wage war against you, and he'll go to before the Lord and say, see, he wasn't worthy. And we need to understand, we need to repent and get out of that. Because, you know, deceitfulness of sin will harden your heart. It'll harden your heart. Do you understand that sin is deceitful? A little leaven leavens the whole lump. Do you have a little bit of sin in your life? Just not a lot, not the big one, just a little bit. It leavens the whole lump. Eventually, sin, the law showed that sin was exceedingly sinful. So much so that Jesus Christ, the perfect man, the God-man, had to come and be put upon a cross brutally and scourged. By his stripes we were healed. And those very stripes were put upon his back because of us, because of our rebellion. Do you understand that? That he's willing to overlook that. He says, come, though your sins be as red as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. He's willing to overlook everything and walk in newness of life. Do you want that newness? Do you want to be regenerated? Or are you content with the life now and say, no, Lord, I want to hold on to it. It's my life. Mine. I didn't give it to myself. I'm not going to subject to you, but I'm going to rebel. And that's what sin is, a rebellion against God, because he said, go and sin no more. If your right hand offends you, cut it off. Cast it from you. Don't even keep it near you. Throw it away. Lest you be tempted to take it back. Just get rid of it. Cast it away. If your eye offends you, take it out and pluck it out and throw it away. Because it's better to enter into heaven maimed and injured than to go to hellfire whole. You know, we need to understand that Jesus is the way. He is the truth. He's the door. And he's the good shepherd. You know, you guys are like sheep scattered. Satan is like a roaring lion. Sheep are no match for lions. He's coming to devour you. The enemy said he has come to... Jesus said that the enemy has come to kill, steal, and destroy. But the Son of Man was manifested that he may destroy the works of the devil. Do you understand that through the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ, you can overcome the works of the devil? It says, behold, I give you power over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. But rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rejoice rather because your name is written in heaven. Is your name written in the book of life? Is your name going to be found when he opens the book and says, yes, I know him. Welcome in? Or is he going to say no outer into outer darkness? You know, and any of these preachers that are adding to the word of God or taking away by omitting and not preaching the whole counsel, it says, if they take away from my word, will I take away their name out of the book of life? But if any man adds to my word, I shall take these plagues that are written in this book and I shall add them unto him. Do you understand? These are serious implications. This isn't just something you add to your life. It's a change of life. It is life. The very words that come forth out of the Bible are life. They are spirit and they are truth. The word is truth, God. Sanctify them with their truth. Sanctify them, Lord. Give them the truth. Give them the truth that they may not be blinded by Satan anymore. Lord, Jesus came just for that reason, to destroy the works of the devil. He's been a liar from the beginning. He's the father of all lies. And whatever he speaks so forth is a lie, but he masquerades as an angel of light. You know, it reminds me in Timothy where it says these people, these men in the last days will have a form of godliness, but they will deny the power thereof. They deny the power to live holy. They deny the power to come over sin, but they go to church every Sunday. They say a couple hallelujahs, a couple amens, and maybe even know a couple scriptures. They have that form. They have that appearance. But inside, they're empty. They're whitewashed tombs full of dead men's bones.
please, please, please repent.
Please seek the Lord. This is a plea warning you. I can't condemn you. I can only warn you and love you as my neighbor. I'm telling you that your sin is separating you from the Lord.
What's going on, sir?
Gotta warn
these
people.
It's like so loud. It's not gentle.
Amen.
Is that where our master?
Jesus went upon the rooftops. They go upon the rooftops and housetops and proclaim the gospel. I tell you in secret, proclaim upon the housetops. You know, go compel them to come in that my house may be full. We need this house to be full. Jesus is gone. Jesus went upon a mountain, sir, and he says, to whom much is given, much is required. I'm expected to reach more people because I have a bullhorn. I'm expected to preach to more people. And I need to wash my hands, because if I don't warn the wicked in their error, their blood is upon my hands. I don't want your blood upon my hands. I want to be clean before the Lord. You know, if a man that is righteous turns from his righteousness and goes back to sin, all of his righteous deeds shall be forgotten. But if any man who is wicked will forsake his wicked ways and come to the Lord, all of his wicked deeds will be forgotten. Wherefore, if my people that are called by my name will humble themselves, pray, and seek my face, and forsake their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and I will answer their prayers, and I will heal their land. I'll forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. You know, we need to preach the word. 2 Timothy 4:2 says, we need to preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season, reproving, rebuking, exhorting with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they'll heap upon themselves teachers according to their own lusts. And their ears will be turned from the truth, but unto fables. You believe in fables. People will believe in what Discovery Channel tells them or National Geographic, but they will not believe the word of God, which is tried like silver in a fiery furnace. Coming out pure every time. It proves itself. I don't need to prove it. It stands alone.
Across the road, I see you.
Please, folks, please turn to Jesus Christ. He offers you newness in life that we do not deserve. But he sanctifies you, and he calls you a saint. And he will say, welcome in. And he will give you a crown of life to those who love him. And you can throw it at his feet and say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain before the foundations of the world. Worthy. Give him the praise. Do not walk around with a deaf ear and a hardened heart. Isaiah said, all the day long have I stretched forth my hands to stiff-necked people and a rebellious generation. I'm nervous because no one's saying, yes, yes, I agree. This is wicked. You know, they're professing to know God and their works are denying him. Please understand. Don't let your eyes be blinded any longer. Do not let the love of this life, do not let the worries of this life choke out the seed. You understand that when you sow the seed, Satan comes on the ones that fell on stony ground immediately and takes it up. He's taking it out of your heart. But the ones that fell upon thorny ground get choked out by the cares and worries of this life after they've received it with gladness. And the ones that fell upon good soil grew and bring forth fruit, some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. You need to bring forth fruits worthy of repentance. You need to fall on that good ground. Ask the Lord to cultivate the soil of your heart. Ask him, say, Lord, please, please sow seeds upon my heart that I may repent and come and bring forth fruit into your kingdom. That I may bring forth fruit worthy of repentance. By their fruit you shall know them, because a good tree cannot bear bad fruit, neither a bad tree good fruit. But the axe is laid in every tree that does not bear good fruit, and it shall be cut down and thrown into the fire. The fire is hell. You know, there's tares amongst the wheat. The wheat and the tares, they look the same when they're young. But when they start bringing forth fruit and they're ready to be harvested, then they shall be gathered up of men, the tares shall be gathered up of men and thrown into the fire. Just because some people say, yes, I'm a Christian, but I'm a Pentecostal, and yes, I'm a Christian, but I'm a Baptist, yes, I'm a Christian, but and they all have this form, yes, we all believe in Jesus. But they're not the true wheat. They're not true to the harvest. They will not, you know, the harvest, the Bible says, is the end of the world. When the angels come back reaping the harvest of the Lord and bringing those back to reign eternally with them. Will that be you? Will you be resurrected under the resurrection of life or under the resurrection of damnation? But you will stand before a holy and righteous God and give an account. Will you be covered by the blood of Jesus Christ? Or will you be standing there giving an account on your own self to a God who created you? Please be reconciled back to God. Come back like the prodigal son who was received with gladness. You know, the angels in heaven rejoice when a sinner comes to repentance. We can have a party in heaven right now, not a party on the streets, not a fake revival, not a fake spirit. Please, Please repent.